kept him from total despair was the fact that those kids were together. And this time Al really sunk into a serious depression and was saved by, I think if the Hamburg Railroad Station was your sort of trauma number one, the happy moment number one was your experience at the High School of Music and Art.
Yeah, the High School of Music and Art. I bless Fiorello LaGuardia every chance I get because he created this high school for me just when I needed it. In 1936, that was the, I was in the first class, and there I met all the artists and writers whom I got to know later on and professionally. And that high school was just it was just wonderful, and I think it probably still is. But I owe a lot to that school, and the Mad Magazine, which I eventually wound up being a part of, was created by Harvey Kurtzman, who went to that school. Will Elder was also in that school, and he was worked with Harvey Kurtzman to create Mad. So, and there are many, many more. I can't remember all their names offhand, but the school created a lot of very talented people and gave them a boost during a very difficult time in the economy of the country. It probably was worse, the economy was worse then by far than it is today, so gives you some perspective.
What struck me when I was researching this book with Al was that in that class, Al and Willie Elder were in the first class at the High School of Music and Art. When they were seniors, Harvey Kurtzman was a freshman. And by the time that Will and Al were seniors, they were very well known in the school and very much admired by their classmates. And of course, Al was posting things he shouldn't be posting on bulletin boards and getting a lot of attention for that. But the thing that just made me happy as the writer of this book was that I learned from talking to Adele Kurtzman that Harvey Kurtzman, when he was a little boy, used to ride around his neighborhood distributing little magazines that he had made. I mean, this is like probably as a preschooler, you know, just handing out little things, or maybe as a grammar school kid. And it was his stated ambition all of his life to make a comic magazine. And when he saw Al's work, they were never really friends at the High School of Music and Art, but when he saw Al's work on the bulletin boards of the high school, he thought and said, someday I'm going to make a magazine and he's going to be in it, and so is Will Elder. So, you know, that's a kind of shiver down the spine kind of stuff I like. And indeed that happened. But before that, a lot else happened. And I think maybe, I don't know, where are we for time? Are we, like, out of it? Five? Okay. So, I was thinking that it would be fun to
Should
talk
I
about...
tap dance?
No, I thought... No. Not a little close to the edge, but I think we could...
I've always been close to the edge.
Not yet. Not so fast. I was thinking about Al's, and one of my favorite things is Al's first satiric character. So tell him about Inferior Man and his droopy tights. I mean, this is at a time. This is World War II time. Everybody's into Superman, and he's like representing the strength of America. And so, of course, he comes up with Inferior Man. So I love it when you talk about him.
It's a cheap shot. Inferior Man.
Hey, aren't they all?
Well, I looked at Superman very carefully, and I thought, well, you know, I could create a character like that. The problem, however, is that I never had the ability of putting muscles in the body where they belong. Anatomy was never my strong suit. I could draw from a model pretty well, but I could not remember where the biceps were and the triceps and all those things are. And you really have to show all of those muscles through the underwear that these superheroes wear. And so it occurred to me, why do I have to try to beat them at their game? Why not do something on my own? And I created a little guy whom I called Inferior Man. And he was an accountant in the daytime. if there are accountants, I don't mean to make fun of accountants, but he needed an alter ego. And so he would put on a cape, and I put long socks on him with garters, which made him look a little odd. And he would try to flit from place to place, but
did he ever get airborne?
No, he didn't get airborne. He fell.
Flit and fall.
Actually, full disclosure, I never wrote a complete story about him. I never had a full drawn adventure of him. I just drew a picture of him and two of the evil characters that he may have to fight. And somebody told me that Will Eisner, one of the greatest cartoonists ever, was looking for people to, he had a bunch of magazines and he needed material. So I went there and showed this to him, and he was amused by it. And he said, I'm going to hire you at $10 a week, and you can draw this feature, and I'll put it in to my magazines as a one-page or a two-page filler. And that was my first job. And he also changed the character from an accountant to a private in the uniform distribution department. I forget what they're called, but and I think this is what killed it, because I had a whole bunch of ideas of what I could do with accountants, but nothing to do with little soldiers. So
the funniest part about Inferior Man, who also had an eye emblazoned right on his underwear, was that he would go after trouble, but if it looked like it was a little too threatening, he would get into a phone booth and get back into his accountant's clothes. So, I mean, he was really a full satiric Superman.
Yeah, that was a story outline I showed Will, and he liked it, but he says, you know, we're in the war now. Everything is about the war. You have to put Inferior Man into uniform. And suddenly I didn't know how to write a story, because I had no experience in the Army, and up to that point anyway. And it didn't gel for me. And after about 3 or 4 months, or maybe 3 or 4 weeks, I don't remember exactly, this is so long ago, he said, I'm going to have to let you go, but I know somebody who can use a penciler. And his name was Ed Cronin, and shipped me over there. And I worked for him for a while.
And then Stan Lee.
And then Stan Lee.
And then ultimately, humbug, Trump.
Well, humbug, that's much later.
And Matt. Well, we're running out of time. We have to go fast.
You skipped my military service, which was,
I thought that would be
so
okay.
Distinguished.
He was in charge of a rehab hospital where he was supposed to cheer up people who were the victims of post-traumatic stress, or at the time was called shell shock. So what he did, and this was at the Biltmore Hotel in Coral Gables, it was like the best place Al ever slept. And what he did to cheer the soldiers up was to get some co-eds from a nearby university to pose in bathing suits for an art therapy class.
On the golf course. It was really very pleasant. It was lovely.
It did him a world of good.
Yeah.
So I think we need to stop talking, but we're happy to have questions. People must have questions for Al, for me, anybody?
You don't have to buy the book because we've told you the whole book.
Did you ever go back to Lithuania to see what became of it after the war?
I had an opportunity to do that. MAD used to take its entire staff, both permanent staff and all of us freelance writers and artists, on an annual trip, which, by the way, was wonderful because we use a cliche saying we were a family. Prior to that, we were just a bunch of different people living in different places, and on these trips we really became a family. All the writers and artists got to know each other. And on one of these trips, heading to Moscow, Bill Gaines came over to me and said, because he knew part of my story, and he said to me, would you like to take a side trip? I can arrange it for you and go to your mother's birthplace and also death. And I said to him, I'm not inclined to do that because it's like visiting a cemetery. I mean, I remember it as a very, very lively place. The ghetto that I lived in was a really bustling community of people with synagogues and community centers and with a soccer team and even Boy Scouts who were hoping to go to Palestine someday were in training. And so it was a very interesting community in that way. It was poor, very poor and very backward, but it was religious. But I felt that with none of those people alive any longer, that would be truly depressing for me.
Yes, sir.
Hi. Can you talk a little bit about the early days of Mad Magazine?
The early days of, gentlemen would like to know a little bit more about the early days of Mad Magazine.
I was not with Mad Magazine in its earliest days. I came to Mad when it became a 25-cent magazine. The earliest days was a comic book, for a 10-cent comic book. And that magazine, the comic book, was written by Harvey Kurtzman and illustrated by other EC cartoonists such as Will Elder, John Severin, Jack Davis, and Wally Wood. And when it turned into a magazine, that's when Harvey Kurtzman contacted me, and I came on board, I think, on the 26th issue. That was my first assignment. But that's very long time ago because I think they're on to number 518 now. So I've been with them since 1955, 56. I can tell you about that period if you'd like to know. As I mentioned before, for me personally, it was like paradise because being able to come up with anything that struck me